I spoke from kind of associate reggae now with Rastafarian religion, you know.
Yeah.
And it's like we've shown that it isn't.
Yeah, I mean, all the numbers on the Labour of Love album, none of them are anything to do with the Rasta doctrine. Well, reggae was adapted in about 68, 69 by Rastas. Before that, it was just, you know, pop music, lovers music.
Stupid me. I always thought that Rastas and reggae went all the way back to, like, 1963.
No. Uh-huh. I think, really, that the first Rasta bit happened in 69 with African Herbsman, Bob Marley's African Herbsman album. And before that, there'd been a few, you know, like Rivers of Babylon by the Ethiopians and things like that. But it was mainly dance music, you know. And one of the questions that we get asked most often in interviews is, where, you know, why do you play reggae? Where, you know, what were your influences? And these 10 tracks are our influences.
So it speaks for you.
Yeah.
Wanted to buy. There's a certain political content to some of your music, but when you come over here to North America, are you aware of the fact that there's really no working class here at all, and so the experience that people bring to your concerts is quite different from the ones you might be used to in England?
True. More emphasis is placed on our music here, you know what I mean, which is, I think, a good thing, you know what I mean, people aren't as aware.
Because basically, we wanted to be a band. I mean, the political content of our lyrics is simply because we've got lyrics, you know what I mean?
Yeah, we have to write about something.
Yeah. Primarily, we want to be a band. We all want to be, like, good musicians, you know. I want to be Charlie Parker or something like that, you know.
I've done 40 shows before, and it often amuses me looking around to see how people dance. They don't really necessarily have it.
Astro
were here, we could ask him to do us a demo, you know.
Yeah. You'll notice, right, that...
But can you?
You come to the gigs and at least one of us will crack up during the concert because you've got to watch these people.
Yeah,
wriggling around like this, you know. We're all getting into a nice mellow groove like this and they're going out and shit on the dance floor. Yeah.
And like, it's still cool, you know what I mean?
You do have to laugh.
Do you have any helpful hints on how to count reggae rhythm?
I wouldn't want to stop him doing it because he keeps it fun.
Yeah, it's good. We're going to have, like, as a support act on the next tour, you know, dance lessons. Yeah.
An instrument or a typewriter. I mean, we locked ourselves away for 6 months, and if you did that with a typewriter, you'd come out, you know, being able to type.
130,000 words a minute.
Yeah, it might be an unorthodox way of typing, you know, using your elbows and things, but...
Yeah.
You'd still learn how to type.
None of us are, like, accomplished musicians, you know. It's not as if we're playing, like, impresario kind of music, you know.
But you were the one who just said that you wanted to play like Charlie Parker.
I do, yeah, but I'm being honest about what we do.
Yeah.
Now, it's not like some big achievement that there's 8 of us to all play in time.
Uh-huh.
I want to play guitar like Charlie Parker. Because I think she's great.
She was brilliant.
This is an award that we were just given by the Bico Rodney Malcolm Coalition. And it's proudly presented to us.
To you?
For our principled stand in refusing to perform in racist South Africa.
In line
with the cultural boycott of apartheid. Culture has a part to play. Zania shall be free.
Were you very flattered when you were given that?
Very proud of that. Very moved.
Very moved.